Gotta raise a little hell.
A police inquiry that began with the horrifying story of a Scottish grandfather has grown into the biggest child abuse investigation in the UK.
It had become one of the largest police investigations of its kind in the country.
Arm shoulder height. Lift.
MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre in the 1980s. At the time, the Conservative government talked of a short, sharp shock for young lawbreakers.
These will be no holiday camps. And I sincerely hope that those who attend them will not ever want to go back there.
In the 1970s and 80s, thousands of teenagers and young men were dispatched to a borstal in County Durham. 3 decades on from the closure of MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre, huge numbers of former inmates have come forward to say they were abused behind its bars.
Mr. Speaker, MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre in my constituency was a living hell for the boys and young men sent there from across the UK in the 70s and 80s. Rape and torture were commonplace.
A huge amount of people come forward that have been physically assaulted. When they went to this place, they were faced with what was effectively a brutal regime. And if you ended up in the kitchens in that brutal regime, you would almost certainly be raped and sexually assaulted. So my feelings and that of the team are dead straightforward. This is horrific.
Howdy and welcome to the Dungeon, MADMILLER Podcast. And today's guest that I've got is my friend from who was a inmate like me at MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre, the fucking hellhole on earth. So my mate, what's your story about MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre?
MEDOMSLEY Detention Centre was a concentration camp. It was run like one. The beatings went from the minute you went in.
What was it like for you when you first went in? What happened?
When I first went in, I got my head brayed off a stone wall. There was a big plaque in the gatehouse.
No.
I got my head brayed off there. And that's when I realised what was going on. You hear stories about MEDOMSLEY. People that's been in, this happens, that happens. And you think, well, that's MEDOMSLEY. But when I went in, it was worse than what people had said.
Yeah, I'd been told about it. I knew about MEDOMSLEY before I went in.
Like, a lot of people were saying when they got up to MEDOMSLEY, oh, that was fuck all that. That was fuck all that. But I believe they were saying that because 9 times out of 10, once you went there, you couldn't go back. A lot of people didn't go. Some people did.
Yeah.
But a lot of people didn't.
I didn't.
Neither did I.
And you know, that is when I got out, I was having fucking nightmares. I was back in. Fucking nightmare. So my story with regards to, you know, when you first go in, is pretty much the same as everybody's I've heard. You know, what's your name? Brian Miller.
Bat.
Bang. Well, it wasn't just one, it was a few of them. And I don't know if you feel the same way, but you know when you're getting in induction thing, when you have to take all your clothes off and you stand there. You know what I mean? What's these fuckers doing? Standing, staring at you, fucking bollock naked. You know what I mean? The dirty bastards.
Well, what happened to me was there was like four were sentenced at Kenton Bar Crown Court.
Ah, same place.
And we got one the coach, the first stop was MEDOMSLEY.
Yeah.
And I had upset one of the prison officers in the courts.
Never.
Because I had to wait for the verdict.
Uh-huh.
And when I've come up, because in Kenton Bar, the cells were up above the courts.
Yeah.
He went up the stairs. When he sees what happened, I went 3 months detention centre. He's rubbed his hands. He went, excellent, excellent. And
that's what they were like in the reception?
When the coach pulled up, you had like a prison officer getting off the coach with the files and properties. And I seen him talking to this other prison officer from MEDOMSLEY.
Yeah, yeah.
So We got off the coach, went through the gate, goes in the gatehouse. Which one of you was his tool or me, sir? He just, by the side, I'd hair at the time, and he braided me head off the wall, but that was like a big brass plaque. I don't even remember it.
I can't remember, to be honest.
And I can remember, my head got braided off. And I was like stunned a bit.
Yeah.
And he went, no fucking right on the walls in here.
Yeah.
And then run across the yard to the door, then screw open the door, then you had to run down this dead narrow corridor to another door and wait for him till you got the reception. And that's when it hits you.
Yeah. Yeah. I knew immediately when I went in and that's my name, and the started punching us in the face. I knew this is it. They're telling you this is how it's gonna be, motherfucker. And it was, yeah. So you go for, did you go straight into the dorms or did you have a cell?
Straight into the dorms that night.
Because when I went in, I went into a separate cell until the following day. And
I think different years, there was different rules.
Right.
Like when I was in, there was a
when were you in what year?
85.
85, aye, that's
fine. There was a blue tie and a red tie, but other kids who had been in tears used to get a green tie.
Yeah, green tie, aye.
Aye. But as I say, that when I'm standing front, there's four stand in front of this screwed desk, Ginger Boyle. Never forget it.
Yeah.
There's a line. And under his desk was like all these religions. And you had to tell them what religion you were. And then you had to take your clothes off. And they were put into a box.
Yeah, and then, that's what happened, right?
And then there was like these cover things with a bath, and
you had a bath.
Then you had to get a bath. The water was about 3 inches deep. Yeah, yeah.
No, I heard Eric Sampson on a podcast, and I've met Eric, as you have, mm-hmm. as well. He's a nice bloke, and he said his water was scadding hot.
Mm-hmm.
Mine was fucking ice freezing. You know what I mean? My balls went inside us when I went in it. But you know what? The humiliation of having to stand there. In front of the screws. Now, the bloke who came in with me, the same day, same place, he was standing next to his bollock naked, and yet he has a funny one, like, he had about 150 tattoos, he had a fish on his head, and he was called Kev Turner, he was a tattoo artist.
I know.
Aye, that was fucking bizarre, that, like. So what happened after you went there? Did you go to the dorm?
What happened was we got humiliated in front of Ginger Boyle.
Right.
Clothes off, bath. Then you had to go into their clothes. But when a officer come into the reception, you had to jump up.
Aye.
If you sat down, if you're sitting down and an officer come present, you didn't stand up, you were beaten.
Aye.
Severely, you know. And then what... It went over really quick in reception, to be quite honest.
Aye.
There was only four were coming that night.
Yeah.
Then we went to the recreation room.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, I always remember the door opening and I seen a kid sitting like that. Looks so, but ready to burst.
Aye.
And the expression on some of these kids' faces.
Oh, I know.
fucking
nightmare.
Just sitting by the cells, not taunting nobody and... And then you got torn with a few kids and that, where you're from, all that crap, what you're in for and all that shit.
Yeah.
Dad, do you know this one? Do you know that one? And then the recreation, they shouted at her. We had to get with kit.
Aye, aye.
So you had like a bedroll, a pillowcase and...
Yeah, certain way on it.
So they only put me in a dorm by myself, didn't they?
Did they?
So
unpopular, were you?
So I'm in this dorm by myself, facing the recess. So
aye.
I pulled all my clothes on hangers, didn't I? Well, it's bed packs and
yeah, nah.
So the next morning, I woke up, and it must have been early, and I only went in the recess and got washed.
Yeah.
Went back in my dorm, and then I just heard this, like. Racket, it was a screw hitting a fire extinguisher with a stick. Fall out! So you had to run out.
Because that's what you used to say, didn't it? Fallout meant was get your fucking arses out.
And you had to run up this corridor, then up the corridor, then at the top of the corridor there's a screw with a bin. You had to run around the bin and back down while you're counted. Well, I'm standing there like that, what's going on?
Aye.
Kid, when he had me, just run up there, just run up there.
Aye, aye. I'll tell you one thing, I've got to say this, like, you could always tell the new starters, right?
Aye.
Especially in the morning when you had to have a shave. Now, the way it worked, it was like they were constantly shouting, come on, come on, come on. And there was like 3 mirrors and 20 people trying to shave themselves. And the new people cut the fucking ribbons all over ya. You know what I mean? Can you remember?
Oh, the new kid coming with the tash.
Aye.
Not shaving it off.
Aye.
Getting pulled by the tash back the recess till they cut it off.
Fucking nutters.
But as I say, that was the Saturday I'm in the dorm by myself.
Yeah, yeah.
And the screw coming out at breakfast, he went, what's all this? I said, well, I found me stuff. He says, in here you do bed packs.
Yeah.
And he's laying the load out of his.
Yeah.
He says, so when I come back, I didn't have a clue.
I didn't have a clue
what to do. So this kid was walking down the corridor and he showed us like how to do the bed pack and that.
So just explain, bed pack is like, it's the blankets in it and then the certain things and then you got to fold them over so they're like
perfect square. Then
you
have your clothes all full of your shorts, your shirt, so I just finished it and there's a screw in there called Rough Puffy, his nickname was.
I can't remember him, like.
He wasn't a bad screw.
Aye.
And he went, get your kit. And I thought, oh, the courts have made a mistake letting us go. But he said,
not a fucking chance.
He said, you're going on the hospital wing.
Yeah.
So I'm on the hospital wing. They got me reports back from the hospital.
Yeah.
And I thought, this is gosh, watching all them do pain into the train out the window. But what did shock us, Brian?
What?
Like, that was the Saturday. On the Sunday, the screw made us go outside.
What for?
Fresh air while they were doing pain at. And I actually witnessed this. I seen it with my own eyes. And I will take a lie detector test. I seen Christopher Onslow whack a kid across the ankles with a hockey stick.
He did it to me?
And why he hit him with a hockey stick for was...
What?
Because the kid tackled him.
Is that what it was?
The kid tackled him. Yeah, well, that's what you do when you're playing games. You tackle each other.
Well, that's what happened to me with Onslow, right? Onslow was the biggest bastard in there, right? A total sadistic bastard, right? And he wouldn't have dared done anything that was outside because I'd have smashed his fucking face in, right? What he did was, while playing hockey... or shinty or something like that. And I remember, he had a way of talking, he was like a robot, wasn't he? Right, the next person that lets that hockey stick too high is going to get it. And that was obviously me, wasn't it? He fucking attacked us. Not whacking us in the body, in the head.
Oh, you had no shame when he hit you.
And he did it in front of every fucker, you know what I mean?
See, this is the thing, right? On the parade square, like...
Yeah, yeah.
Later on in the parade square... You had like people walking the dogs around the fence and
on
the outside, and he was just shouting and hitting you in front of everybody.
Oh, he didn't give
a care in the world. It's if he was allowed to do it.
He's a total cunt.
But it wasn't just him, all of them.
No, they're all fucking full of shit.
They had a couple that didn't hit you, but they were there when you were getting hit, sort of as bad as them.
I tell you what I thought was all right, right? You know the bloke that was sort of like under Onslow, so when Onslow was off, he took over and was in charge. He had a beard, I can't remember what his name was.
Scott.
I don't know who he was, but he was a kind of nice bloke, actually.
Was an Orriman. See, you were there years before me, Brian, so...
It was a guy with a beard.
See, when I was there, there was a guy with a beard and he was a bastard.
Maybe he might have fucking turned.
He was called Danny Scott, he was an Irishman.
No, he was quite a young bloke.
So to cut a long story short.
Aye, sorry.
I'm out of the hospital wing. And I get to put in a dorm with these kids. So thought, normal regime.
Yeah.
So the next day, we're done with PE.
Yeah.
Now, the gym was getting modernised when I was there.
Right.
So we had to do the exercises and what have you in the multi-gym.
Right.
But you can imagine, it's the end of June.
Yeah.
It's red hot. You didn't have no door open or nothing.
Fucking did that.
And they were doing the bench training. Now, everyone was staring at me.
I remember
and the
that.
Sweat was just dripping, and I mean dripping up.
Yeah,
us.
Yeah.
And the next thing I know, I was on the floor. I'd passed out.
Fuck me.
That
bench training was fucking hard.
Oh, well, I passed out, right? And I remember, I don't know how I got up. He had a hold of us.
Who?
This gym screw, Scott, Danny right. Scott, the Irishman.
Right.
And he was just brain into us. Well, he hit us and I hit the floor again. I was like, he must have knocked us out or something. And then he dragged us up by the hair, because I had hair then. He dragged us up by the hair. And when he dragged us up, I vomited.
Aye, aye.
And he rubbed my face in it, like you do with a dog.
Dirty cunt.
By the hair, and I had to wipe her up in my gym vest. And then I realised where I was, what was happening. I knew the dance then. It's going to be.
I knew the dance.
I thought this place is going to be tough for the next 9 weeks.
Fucking right.
And it was.
Oh, aye.
But I honestly say, the way I sweated that day in the gym, I've never sweated like that before in my life. In a sauna, yes.
You know what I was like? I became a bodybuilder and all this shit, right? But back then, I didn't like fucking exercise, you know what I mean? I didn't like it one little bit. But the thing I was told about before I went in is the fence. You know, that was the fucking biggest nightmare.
No, it's opposite tracked here because I didn't mind the fence. I hated the PE, right?
Aye, aye.
When I was young, I could run. That's the thing, I could run.
Fuck that.
And I could do the fence, no problem.
Yeah.
Didn't get us wrong, it fucked us, but I still could do it.
But I mean, I could do it, right? But it was like the fear, because I'd been told. And I was one of, you know, when you do the fence, it's 4.5 laps in 35 minutes. Now, I remember, because I was so quick at running, I was only 10.5 stone at the time. What we had to do was the faster runners had to go to the back to push the slower runners, because you had to do it in 35 minutes. Not just you, the last
Everybody.
Person. The last person has to go through with 35 minutes. So the faster runner's at the back pushing like fuck. Now, I remember this one lad, he was called Dez. I don't know. He had glasses. He was a big lad. He was about, well, he was a big fat one, like, you know what I mean? But we were, and I felt so sorry for him. I'm pushing and pushing. And this fence, you know, it's on an incline, it parts, isn't it, like that?
See, what people don't realise, Medemsley's flat, but the bottom field where you're on the fence.
It's fucking like that, aye?
It's so steep, and that's, you got your punishment on that field, your interval training.
Oh, hey, yeah, fuck that. No, but I mean, this kid was crying his eyes out, and we had to be so hard on him.
Mm-hmm.
Push, 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 push. And
well, what I found, it, Brian, is like when I was in, if you were last running that fence, you were punched and kicked.
Oh, aye.
Because there'd be a screw behind you, and he used to wallop you.
And not only that, the threat of you having to do it again. So if you didn't all do it in 35 minutes, you all had to do it again, right? So if anybody fucked up, they got it in the showers, like they got beat up, no doubt about it. I've seen it with my own eyes, you know what I mean? It's shitty, but that's the way it is. If you don't do it, you get beasted by these other inmates, similar as that.
Well, what I found in there, like, it's right what you say, if, like, yeah, do more pay throw people the lads and like it. On my 21st birthday, what do on the parade square, it was a red hot summer's day, July, doing exercises around parade square with Onslow.
Yeah.
And he's making a bunny hop.
Oh, that fucking kills you, that.
Right, now, you can do it once round, but when you, what, this was like the fourth, because one kid couldn't do it, and it was like the fourth time. Those kids falling down, and I didn't know what made us do it, right?
Aye.
I just got him, so I'm not doing it.
Get fucked.
Oh, I did. Oh, I got fucked already.
Oh, aye.
I said, I'm not doing it. Simple as that, sir. Can you remember the outside toilets on the parade square?
I can't remember. I remember the parade square,
but I can't. Toilets.
Can't remember
the
time.
He went, right, everybody get down that field. That field I just told you about, we used to run down. Get down that field, find a little training. And he grabbed me by the hair and he braided my fucking head off the toilet brick wall. And I've still got the scar to this day here.
No. Fucking nut, that's one.
He says, next time, what was it? You ever shout at me like that again, I'll have you tied up, gagged and shagged.
And fucking Raji
Kunz. I thought, you sick piece of shit.
Oh, horrible.
Seeing
man.
That, I'm a young kid.
I know. That's the thing is though, right? I mean, we're all older than that now, right? But at the time we were just kids, these people abused teenagers. Because that's all we were.
You didn't say that like a kid. I'll have you tied up, gagged and shagged. What sort of...
oh, fucking hell.
So getting, that was on my 21st birthday, that. So getting back to Onslow, bang me up the wall, about to go down this big field. And it did, Brian, you know, you said it's like that.
Oh, yeah, it's stupid, like.
You had to like, run up,
yeah.
Piggyback someone, doing piggybacks, one up, bunny hop, and then...
Then bunny hops. Fuck.
You got 5 minutes. I mean, like, the P used to finish at 12 o'clock.
Yeah.
At 5:02. He used to like finish it and you go and get ready.
Yeah.
This day he didn't. We were late going down for dinner. That's how bad it. Oh, he wore what out.
Oh, I tell you what, that fucking name, Onslow must have been fit as fuck. Because he'd done one group, then another group, then
three,
another.
I think he'd done 3-4 groups a day.
He's a fuck. That's why they call him the meme machine.
See, when I was in, he couldn't do much PE because he had just had a hip operation. He had a hip operation. He walked with a limp when I was in. And, he couldn't do much PE himself, but he'd be running around the gym and he'd be walking around opposite with a big stick.
Aye.
And he had to jump over that stick. If you couldn't jump over that stick, you
got hit with that cunt.
You got braided across the shins with it.
I got hit with that cunt. Right. Like, he's a right cunt.
A detention centre, it was a torture chamber.
Well, it was, wasn't it?
It's like, when all them screws went to court,
yeah.
They were like, how can I put this? They got charged. They should have been charged with torture.
I know. Well, it was a torture. I was just watching the other day. You know the intro to this podcast?
Yes.
I think you know Nova. She was an MP and she brought it up in the House of Commons, saying that rape and torture was commonplace. And it's in the introduction to this video. But it's crazy because we're just kids, really.
I can honestly say it, right? Being in there for just under 9 weeks, I never once seen any kid get raped, right?
I know. I did not know what about
I did. It. What I did hear, kids in the middle of the night screaming.
Aye.
No, shouting no.
Fucking no.
In the middle of the night.
That would torture you, that
and
wouldn't
I'm
it?
Thinking, what's going on here? What's he done? But later on, years aye. Later, I found why they were shouting no.
Aye.
They were getting taken out of the detention centre and they were getting whatever was getting done to them.
It's fucking crazy, man. It's absolutely mental. And like, my mom, like, I never said no about no. You know, like, when I was, like, in the letters and that, I never put on get my head kicked in.
Well, you can't because they read the letters, they'll kick your head in.
Exactly.
I had a late line, my mum and dad, how are you? I'm fine. And what's it like? I said, oh, it's okay. It's, you know, you can do
fucking nightmare.
Like when we won, Brian, there was no trainers. You couldn't have, you're allowed nothing.
Nothing.
You couldn't even have a watch. Nothing. No Walkmans, no radios, nothing.
Nothing, not a thing. Nope.
And this is people going, you weren't allowed this. You couldn't wear your own clothes. Like, I think in some jails now, when you see one on the telly, they've got like sports, there was nothing like that.
Yeah, yeah.
It was their clothes, their uniform, no radio, no money sent in.
Nothing.
You couldn't say no in or out. You couldn't smoke.
Nah, no smoking.
No cans of pop.
Nothing. You weren't even allowed your own name.
Like, we...
Can you remember your number?
898 Tool, sir.
Mine was 28768, sir.
I didn't know the full number.
Oh, I did, I fucking right. 28768.
But as I say, I've seen a lot of kids get beat up in there, a lot of kids.
I did too. I tell you what, I saw as well, like, the one thing about Medomsley is, what I thought anyway, it's not the violence so much, it's the anticipation of violence. It's in the air, you know it's going to happen.
Mental torture.
And I've seen people, right, who are not buddies now, but they got on our reach. And I remember seeing these two lads who were big bastards, they weren't soft shits, and they were having an argument about something, and they exploded, right, had a quick fight. It was over in a minute, and they sat down as if nothing had happened, because the screw was going to come in. And that's where it's got your heightened awareness, is there's going to be shit anytime, any moment. You know what I mean?
Oh, was it? It was in the air, because
why?
Every day something happened. the recreation room, something happened.
Oh, yeah.
When you're scrubbing them corridors, you used to have them black boots and you used to scrape the heel so you had to get the Brillo pad and take the black marks off.
Do you know what fucked me off once? I was cleaning in the dorm. I can't remember which day it was. It was the day, I think it was the Thursday or something like that. And I mopped all the floor and all that. And then you have to put this like milky stuff on to make it shine. I was just finishing that, right? A screw come in and he went. He kicked the fucking bucket of water all over the front. He went, clean it up and walked out. What a bastard.
Well, when I first went in there, one cleaning duties.
In
the dorms. And there was me and this young kid, only 17 he was, being no mum and dad, being in the home all his life. He got 28 days for not turning up for summick.
Yeah.
So when you go in there, when I went in, don't know about the year you went, but the year I went in, they used to give you this letter. But the first letter they give you had to go to your mum and dad. And they used to put the video in there.
Oh, I can't remember.
So anyway... So I filled mine in, so we're in the corridors and the screw come and he went to the kid, why did you not put your, was it VO and, you've not sent your letter or your VO out, that was it.
Yeah.
And so you get him hiding and I'm standing there thinking, you piece of shit, the kid was about that big.
I was a skinny little cunt.
It wasn't just a few slaps, you know, Brian. You give this kid a good hiding. And he says, now, why did you not just send your reunion out? He says, well, the thing is, I haven't got a mum and dad.
Fuck me.
And he still hit him.
Cunt.
He still hit him.
Oh, they didn't care, man. Didn't
care. So we had this polished stuff, because in the recesses in there, everything's stainless steel.
Yeah.
And you had this polish, and you had to polish it.
Yeah.
And I'd polish the sinks, the kid, done the toilets, done urinals. And then he come in, he went, who's done this urinal? I went, oh, me, sir. He went, it's spotless. And he just pissed all over it.
What a cunt.
Yeah.
Oh, they were bastards. That's what I'm, you know, when I talk about it, or if I mention anybody, people look at me now, a fucking 61-year-old bloke, right? But back then, I was only 17.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you're 17, you're trying to think you're muckle hard and all of that. I'm fucking sort your shit out. But honestly, inside, I was shitting myself. It looked like a fucking concentration camp when I went in. And it was.
Oh, it was a concentration camp, all right. There's no doubt about that. But the way they treat you, man.
And I thought you couldn't get away from it. There's nothing nowhere you could go.
People say, keep your head down. You couldn't keep your head down because if someone next to you kicked off, you'd get it as well.
I must admit, right, I'm a funny cunt, right? I laugh at a lot of things. And when I first went in there, I was like always laughing. And I remember a lad from North Shields. I'll not say his name because I don't think he wants people to know.
Mm-hmm.
But he was in my dorm as well. And... he goes to me, you need to calm down. You need to calm down. And you could see he was shitting himself. And he was older than me. And I remember being in the, the gym. And you remember when they used to get like one body bent down and the other body bent down and make a horse.
Mm-hmm.
And you had to run and jump over them. Well, I ran right and I fell on top of them and I fell down. I'm pissing myself laughing. Onslow would come up and start kicking us and kicking us. But I was still laughing my head off, like, but there you go.
Because I see when I went in, the gym was getting modernised.
Yeah, yeah.
But my last 2 weeks, the gym had been done.
Yeah.
And You had to climb up ropes, touch the ceiling.
Yeah.
And come back down. But what I used to do, you know them big blue cushion things to yeah. land on?
Yeah, yeah.
I used to touch the ceiling, just land. So yeah. I like cheated. Because you had like so many seconds to do the, so many minutes to do the full course thing. And he caught us one day and he kicked me all over that gym.
Yeah.
But getting back to the other one.
Which one's that?
Danny Scott, who was in the N85.
What, their screw?
Jim Screw. I've never met... They say Onslow was bad. This man was just as bad as him.
Onslow was a cunt.
Danny Scott, if you're watching now, you're a cunt.
Well, come to get you, bastard. No, you know it is, right? I was so frustrated. You see, when I was younger, I was like a fighter. I was always getting in fights. But when I was in there, I felt frustrated because, like, I remember once, well, Onzo, when he was hitting us in the fucking head with a fucking hockey stick, I couldn't do nothing. I had to just fucking stand there. Another time when I said about the, he come up once, right, and he was kneeing us in the leg non-stop, right, and I had to just fucking stand there and take it like a dab gun. I thought, if you were outside, I'd fucking smash your fucking head and all over your cunt.
See, I think Onslow talked to me because I was unfit and I went in. I didn't like PE, I didn't like football.
Yeah.
The only thing I didn't mind doing was run the fence.
I didn't like that. Right? I didn't like
none of it. And you can guarantee nearly every day when I had him, there was an issue with him.
Good.
But did you ever... In the gym where the showers were, he used to come in, everyone was in the shower.
Yeah.
He used to come in with a box.
Didn't know about that, like.
In the box was bars of soap, and he used to pelt them at you.
Did he?
When you're getting hit across the head with a bar of soap, hurts, you know?
Aye.
You know, I'd seen everybody duck. So I duck, I got hit in the back.
What's your back?
I got hit in the back.
Yeah.
With one. So the next time you come with the balls of soap, I just got right in the back where the wall was.
Yeah, yeah.
He loved inflicting violence on people. He loved it. I don't know if it's happened to him for him to carry it on.
I don't know.
But I know he was in the forces because when the war had caught, I went to the trail a lot.
Yeah. I didn't go, mate. Like, but support group, Facebook. People were posting videos, which I was grateful for, so I could see what was going on. Do you know what I mean?
And like, I sat and I watched men break down, giving evidence.
Right.
What was done. Grown men.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they were just sitting, didn't twitch or nothing. I remember it was broken nose. He wasn't there when I was there.
Yeah.
John McGee, he wasn't there when I was there.
He was a bastard.
But Onslow was. But when I was going
to the back, mate.
When I was going to the trail, you had like John McGee, like trying to intimidate the witnesses and public gallery and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Then his son was with him all the time.
I saw weird with him.
And the son was like, he was just a horrible piece of work. He's like trying to wind us up. But what I was trying to tell the kids in the public gallery, don't bite. This is what they want. They want you to kick off.
Now, I've got to bring this up, Ben. Sorry for jumping in. Like, I set up a support group for Facebook 10 years ago or something like that. And a lot of people joined it who were either from MEDMSLEY or wives of partners who passed on and that. So there was a time, right, when somebody infiltrated our group. And I'm sure it was McKay, something to do with him.
It was John McGee's son.
John McGee's son.
John McGee.
No, there was a woman, man. There was a lass. Because she was hurling abuse at me. There was a lass.
Right, I tell you what happened. I tell you what, after the trail, John McGee come on the Facebook, right?
Yeah.
But he went under... he joined he got someone to join the Mermsley page.
Yeah.
A woman.
And yeah, there was a woman, I
think. And that was like, she was like the spy for them.
Yeah.
And then when his dad got the jail,
aye,
he started slagging everybody off.
She was slating me like.
We'll be drinking champagne next week. But what John McGee done was the son, then the third trial.
Yeah.
He phoned his friend up, the governor of Durham Prison, who he was training with. He went, because we had a prison officer from Durham, took some kids to Mermsley, and he seen what was going on. He didn't like it.
Aye.
So he's reported it. So he went to court as a witness. So this John McGee wanted the governor of Durham to have a word with him, not to go.
Right.
So what the governor done was, kept the email, he phoned Durham Police up and got him nicked.
Get in your cunts. So,
John McGee Jr., if you're watching, you got sacked from Franklin Prison, didn't you? You got a suspended sentence.
For being a cunt.
And now he works for an undertaker's driving the vans.
Does he?
You shouldn't be doing that.
Hey, fucking wanker. But I never forget, I was taken back by this lass who was absolutely slating me. Mm-hmm. And I thought, fuck me. It was a time, around about that time, for me as a person who was running this group, right, everybody was paranoid the fuck, weren't they? Who else?
What they were doing was this McGee and his family, they were like trying to wind all the public gallery up to get a reaction.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, when they all got adjourned for sentence.
Yeah.
I went to court and I wanted to see that Onslow's face when he got put away.
Yeah.
Right? So this McGee had said something cocky to me, I just ignored him.
Aye.
And he was that common, his dad was getting out. When he got his, was it 3 and a half years or 3 years?
Is that it? You know what I mean? Fuck me.
But if we've come out the courtroom, he wouldn't come out.
Why?
He got the usher to let him out the side door.
Shitting himself.
Well, cowardness, isn't it?
Aye.
He couldn't face the people he'd upset.
That McGee's all right, cunt. He fucking kicked me so hard. You know, I've never been kicked in the fucking, you know, the bone at the bottom of your back. He kicked me there. He fucking killed us. The bastard.
All right, well, I heard loads of stories about him when I was in there.
He was Irish, wasn't he?
No.
Scottish?
No.
Big John?
Big John McGee was like...
No, he was Irish. Positive.
No,
I remember when he went to fucking...
Hated the Irishman.
Where's your top? That's his. It's in the dorm. While growing fucking garish, boom, kicked the silver in all the bosses.
But as I say, they weren't so big standing that dock when they got sentenced.
Fucking pussies.
We got told, I don't know if it's true or not, but we got told later on off a member of the staff in the court that there were three of them sitting in the cell crying like babies.
Hope so.
But I don't hold us of it, I can't swear to it.
You're only speculating.
I'm speculating, yes, that's a word for it.
Speculating to accumulate.
But they weren't so big then, but they got off very lightly for what they did.
Oh.
Very lightly.
I tell you what, like.
I think it's because of their age. When you had a prison officer from Durham Prison going to court is against another prison officer.
That's fucking bad.
What does that tell you?
That's fucking bad.
It tells you the cunts.
Oh, totally. I mean, what, you know, these prison officers, like normal prison officers, they're just family men making a living to fucking get by. But these cunts in Mermsey were fucking sadistic cunts. Remember German?
I remember German very well.
That shit. He took me from Kenton Bar and Crown Court. And I went with him in a taxi on my own. And we're driving there. And I fell asleep. Right? He's fucking digging us in the ribs, the cunt. Do you know what I mean? I thought, oh, fuck me. I'm even getting in the fucking doors and starting. You know what I mean? He's a little fucking shit he was. His peak of his cap was fucking flat. Wasn't it?
He was a very nice person. He was very, very sharp. Always had a tab in his hand. He went down, obviously, we used to be sitting on the chair with his feet up smoking the tarp. Well, he's dead. He's dead now.
Is he? Thank fuck. Good riddance to bad shit.
I think there's a few of them dead.
You know, I want to touch on this as well. Like, we've spoken about it before. Like, I think I've fucking dealt with my situation from there. I mean, I think with me, it was more frustration that, like, I couldn't get to do anything back.
Yes, yes.
But, like, with our support group, I see a lot of people still in fucking deep, deep pain.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll attest to that, won't you? You know what I mean? A lot of people in there.
It affected a lot of people, Brian.
Big fucking time.
See, I went there, went in, got out, took it on the chin, thought, that's Madmillermusic.
That's what I thought, right?
Then.
You get angry.
then when I got out, where I live, I live just behind the high street.
Yeah.
In the local bar, it's full of all kinds.
Yeah.
And you got on talking to people, oh, you just can't remember what you think of it. And, oh, I was in there in 1970, or I was in there in 19, you know.
Aye.
Big blokes telling you the way it was.
Aye.
And everyone had a story to tell about the place.
Aye.
And you knew they weren't lying or exaggerating. But I just thought, right, I'm out of Madmillermusic, that's it.
Yeah.
Then, a few years later, I walked to my mum said, I need a word with you. I says, right. She says, she had a newspaper, she says, do you know him? Picture of Neville husband.
Oh my God.
I says, I remember him. I says, he was the...
I think he was there when I was there.
I says, he was the cook, the chef.
Yeah.
I says, he wasn't a bad bloke. She went, really? I says, well, he wasn't like horrible to us because we didn't work under him.
No,
I didn't. And she says, well, look what he's charged for. I couldn't believe it.
You know the only thing I can remember him for?
I couldn't believe it.
Is when you get your meal in the morning or after your dinner, when everybody was sat down in that seat and that, he would stand sort of like...
Watching everybody?
At the front there, with his arms crossed, just looking. He was talking to him, like, another screw as well. Like,
Wearing you up? That's what he's doing.
Aye. But I went in at the 22nd of December, 1980, for a fucking Christmas present that was. I was fucking gutted. But you know it is, it was fucking freezing up there.
Oh, you know how you, see, where concert is, right, it's the highest part of the northeast, that's where the Pontop Pike is.
It's fucking freezing.
Oh, it's when it's cold, but in the summer when it's hot, it's hot.
Aye. They made me play football out there, right, with a vest on and a pair of shorts, right, and it was that bad, the blizzards were that bad, I couldn't even see anybody, and we had to stay out there for half an hour, I was fucking freezing. Honestly, it was really, really bad.
That's torture.
I've never seen that again in my life.
That's torture, that doing that is. Watching you freeze in the field, it's torture.
Absolutely fucking nightmare.
If you hold somebody, get somebody's head and pull their hair back and hold salt down their throat, that's torture.
Salt poison, you know.
That's what McGee done, that lad from Hartlepool.
Did he?
You got convicted for it.
Fuck me. So, I want to touch on... it's not very clear on my minds now because a lot of time has passed. But
can I just stop you there, Brian?
Yeah.
I can remember Madmillermusic like it was yesterday. And that's why I had to get counselling for. Because the policeman that interviewed us couldn't believe it. He says, this happened in 1985.
Aye,
but you can remember like it was yesterday.
Yeah, I get it.
Now, when I got out of Madmillermusic, 10 months later, I ended up in Durham Prison.
Yeah.
And I can remember bits of Durham Prison, but...
Nothing like...
No, nothing like Madmillermusic.
And I, because it was so acute, you know, what you've got. It was so acute.
They didn't treat you like shit in Durham Prison.
No.
You know who was boss, them get us wrong. They were the boss.
Aye.
But, like, there was never, like, bunny hop down there or do this or run that fence. It was none of that.
No, you just fucking sat in your cell, didn't you, really?
You were banged up 24-7. You were talked to like an adult.
Aye.
You know?
Well, I've done Durham, like, in 2000. And it was, like, nothing. It was like a rest home, to be honest. But like I never forget, it was like on Christmas Day, and where you get your food in the cafeteria area. I remember there was five lads from North Shields. I'm not gonna name them, like, mm-hmm. but one of them who I knew very well, and he's not a soft shit, he was crying his eyes out on Christmas Day. I think it was like the emotion of like his family not there and all of us do it. He was bawling his eyes out, you know.
See, what you gotta remember, Brian, when I was in there was a kid in, right? He was only 18 and he had two kids.
Yeah.
And like his lass was by herself and
fuck.
He's like he took it bad.
Yeah, yeah.
And some kids tried to, like, you know the fence?
Yeah, yeah.
You know if you get a knife and fork, you can climb up it.
Yeah.
There was a knife and fork caught in the fence. And these kids says it was his. And he lost 7 days for it.
Oh, my God.
And I says the kids, I went, he's banging around. I says, you've grassed the kid up. I says, he's got two bends on the out, man.
That's what I'm shouting.
But it's like, some people can take it and some people can't.
Oh, and it doesn't make them any weaker at all.
You know?
It's just some people sort of like... can just deal with that sort of shit. And I think possibly I'm one of them type of people. It doesn't mean I'm not weak, because I am at certain times.
Mm-hmm.
You fuck, I've got bipolar disorder, ADHD and autism. And I've been in the Morpeth Mental Hospital the last 3 years, every year in a row for the last 3 years. So, yeah. So some people, it really impacts on them. And I tell you, like, some of the stories I've heard from our group, it's been like, it's fucking proper horrible. It's like, you can't help but feel for these people. And it's like as if it just happened yesterday, isn't it?
I always remember sitting in Teesside Crown Court and this kid giving evidence against Onslow.
Yeah.
And you could see he was an alcoholic.
Yeah.
And he turned alcohol, me got Remsley. And he gave evidence against Onslow. He tried to commit suicide in Medmilley. He slashed his wrists.
Yeah.
Because Onslow was on his case all the time. He couldn't handle it. He was a big lad, but he couldn't handle the pressure of getting picked on.
Yeah.
And what happened was they took him to the hospital.
Yeah.
Then they put him in Durham Prison Hospital wing. Then he says, look, after a few days, you've got to go back to Medmilley.
No way.
So he went back, and Onslow had said, look, what are you planning on doing stuff like that for? He says, the paperwork, this is what he said, this is what the lad said, giving his evidence, the paperwork I've had to do through you. But Onslow kept up his case.
Nightmare. Total bastard.
Getting back to the assault course in there, that wasn't there when I was there, but that kid that got stuck on it, Onslow threw bricks at him. He fell, and he broke something in his back or his neck.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
This is how thick Onslow is.
Brian,
this is how stupid Christopher Onslow is.
Yeah.
What he done was, the hospital, I believe, gave him a file to take back to Medmilley. He's only kept it. And when he got raided for
what
he...
They found it.
They found it after all these years. That's how stupid he was.
I'd love to punch that cunt right in the face.
But like,
obviously, I'm not going to be violent, you know what I mean? But it's
getting back to Chris Alonso, right? He got 8.5 years.
And he done fucking half or something, didn't he?
He done half. I believe he done half.
Fucking cunt.
But he got the most. He got the most out of everybody.
You know why? Because he's a total cunt.
I felt sorry for his daughter. Because he's probably told his family, I'm innocent, and like, she went hysterical when I did feel for his daughter.
That's your empathetic mirror neurons working.
No, well. You know, like when you feel sorry for people, like he's probably like, you remember, she's the innocent one.
Of course,
his family.
Wait,
they're innocent, right?
Of course,
and, like, he's going, oh, I've been accused of this, I've been accused of that, and they've automatically took his side.
Well, obviously,
because of the family.
Aye.
But like, really, what he's done was he's lied to his family, hasn't he?
Well, yeah. Obviously, the daughter and that, they should have no fuck fucking.
She was shit. Crying. I felt a bit sorry for her.
Of course.
Because he had Condi, he had Condi's daughter. What I like to say now to every prison officer in Medomsley, if you're watching this, if you're saying I'm talking a lot of crap and it didn't happen, take a lie detector test. That's all I'm asking. Take a lie detector test. Prove us wrong. This didn't happen.
Calm down, calm down.
Prove us wrong.
No, but you're not, it's right. Like, we talked about this just before. And, like, there was only so many officers got taken to court. Now, as I said to you, Onslow and all the rest of them, they didn't do this fucking physical abuse in private. They done it in front of everybody. And there was other screws around watching.
I agree.
Now, as I said to you, there's a saying, a famous saying, all good men need do is nothing to allow evil to succeed. That's all I need to do is nothing. And they did nothing. And evil did succeed. Not now, though.
Well, there's a lad called Kevin Young who...
Oh, yeah.
He was the first... If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't be sitting here the other day. Because he got the ball run from Emsley. He was gang raped.
Terrible.
What happened to him?
Terrible. Seemed like a nice bloke, you know?
He was a lovely kid. He used to ring us up.
I used to text him as well.
I've met him a couple of times, and he told us that these men were wrongly charged. It should have been torture.
Yeah.
Crown officers, if they hit you, it comes under torture. It's supposed to come under torture.
Oh, I do know.
But with them being crown officers and working under the Queen,
yeah,
they got off with a lot.
Like I say, he messaged us and obviously through the group that was set up. And he seemed like a lovely bloke, you know, a lovely bloke. And I seen him on, I think it was Medomsley Heroes or something like that.
Yeah.
So really, he paved the way. And I think Raymond Paul was one of these people who paved the way and had to get the law changed or something like that. And Raymond, spot on bloke. What about this David Caldwell?
Well, I didn't know David Caldwell personally, but I've heard a lot about that lad.
Yeah.
How would I put this?
Well, I have to be careful because it's not.
I know what I'm saying.
It's not like.
No one's been convicted of his killing.
Yeah. And it's all speculation, really. But so if you can sort of give an outline of what it was about.
Well, what I got told.
Right.
This is what I got told of a lad.
Yeah.
That David Caldwell was just a...
Caldwell, innit?
Caldwell, sorry. Was just a normal, quiet kid. Wasn't a bully. Just in there. But a certain officer targeted him. Right?
Aye, aye.
And he was born dead, he was beaten. I believe he was thrown outside in the snow or something. And the one
back, aye, something like that. Aye.
The one back later on, he was gone. He's dead. Now
somebody witnessed it, didn't they?
There's a couple of kids witnessed it.
I've actually spoken to one of them.
I've spoken to two of them.
Right, yeah.
I
think you'll give us the
I spoke to two of them.
Yeah.
And the police were informed a couple of years ago about it.
Yeah.
And the police turned around and said, look, we're quite happy he died of natural causes.
Right. So I just want to stop you there. So I had spoke to that guy who was in, I think, in France.
Yes.
And he said he was witness to
it. He seen everything.
He told the police everything.
He was willing to go as a witness.
Yep, and nothing happened.
No.
Right, I know that for a fact because I actually spoke to him, right? And then, I think it was his sister went to view the body.
Yeah, I believe the sister went to see him on a visit.
No.
And he had marks on the visit on his neck, and she went off it.
No, this is when he was dead, I think.
Yes.
Because she remarked upon the... marks on all his legs and that?
Yes.
I might be wrong. I'm speculating.
Well, I'm speculating this. I got told that the sister visited him in the visiting room.
Yeah.
And he had marks on him, and she kicked off the marks, and he says, look, just forget about it. I've got to go back through there.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when she had to go and identify the body, she pulled the sheet off him, and he was covered from head to toe. I'm speculating.
Aye, aye.
He was covered from head to toe in bruises.
Well, put this way, right, and as I said to you before, before we come on air sort of thing, I said to you, now, if you went back in time to the time it happened, and you see as, oh, that this prison officer killed him by doing what he did to him,
mm-hmm.
physically torturing him, really,
mm-hmm.
I think he had asthma or something, like that. Mm. Was it asthma?
I think he might have.
Yeah, I think he had asthma.
Was it something to do with the...
Yeah, something like that.
What are they called, inhalers?
So anyway, if I went back in time to that time and said, oh, that officer killed him, you'd look and say, don't be fucking stupid, man. He's a fucking officer. Now, fast forward to now. Now, these officers have been proven to be fucking evil cunts, right? So therefore, if you have that information and you go back in time and then say it, it's very likely or a probability that it could have happened.
See, Brian, what you got to remember is, right, we're MEDOMSLEY, right?
Yeah.
It's you're walking out of our world into their world,
yeah.
Right? Now, what goes on in their world, nobody's allowed in to see.
Yeah.
So with them being crown officers, the believer of everybody.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Oh, I get you, aye.
No,
but you know what I mean, though? If he's an evil cunt now, right, and he's being prosecuted.
Yes, oh, yeah, I totally agree with you.
He was prosecuted on instances that happened back in that time. So let's just take it one step further. So he's brutally beating people and all the rest of it.
For fun.
So what's the leap to beating people up the fork and beating someone up the fork and they die? What's mm-hmm. it? It's not a massive leap, is it?
Of course it's not. Definitely not.
Fucking idiot.
But this is where like they're protected because it's in their detention centre.
Yeah, yeah.
The police just can't go in there when they want.
No.
But there was a few killings murders or killings or whatever in that place over the years. Nobody was ever brought to justice for it.
No.
You know?
I mean, it took 40 years to get fucking justice out of these fuckers. And what did they get? Epoxy 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years or whatever it was. Do you know what I mean? It's fucking disgrace.
Well, two of them, the last two, what happened to them again? One died and one, he's got dementia, he's unfit to stand trial.
Fucking unreal.
But what I believe is there's hospital wings.
Exactly.
So the state's got to keep him. Are these men still getting the pensions that are being convicted?
Probably. Cunts. Do you know what I mean? But I mean, there'd be a lot of people out there watching this thinking, why are you still banging on about it? Because you know what is? Like I said before, a lot of these people who suffered, it's just like it happened yesterday. It's that yes, fresh in their mind.
It is. They're traumatised by it.
And like, these people have to live it over and over again. It's heartbreaking when, like, because we've been in this MEDOMSLEY bubble and we speak to everybody, we know what's going on in these people's minds. And it's fucking, your mental health is the most important thing. You know what I mean? Because if your mind's fucked, you know, where the mind goes, the body follows. You know what I mean? So,
like, another thing, Brian, like, if you've got all these people saying things about a prison officer, right?
Aye, aye.
What he's done to them. Kids from all different areas, all different years, all different, they weren't in together.
Uh-huh.
There's got to be some truth in it. They couldn't have all got together and made it up. It's impossible.
There's a saying. Lightning doesn't strike 1,800 times in the same place. Do you get it? So all these 1,800 people that like came forward, lightning doesn't strike 1,800 times, does it, in the same place? Does it? Fuck.
Well, all I can say is they got off for murder.
They certainly got off for fucking torture. That's it.
The torture. I've actually read the book with Kevin Young. It's torture what these men should be in charge with, and like when you've got Durham police investigating, we should have an independent police force.
Yeah.
We shouldn't have Durham police.
Yeah.
Because at the courts, the victims were looked down on. It wasn't a good morning, are you okay? But if Onslow and them were getting special treatment, mini buses to the court. But the victims were just like looked down on.
Fucking shite.
You know? And I had it out with one of the officers in there.
Did you?
Oh, total stress. I said, we're not that bad, you know. She said, well, what do you, I said, you're all looking down your nose at us. And she says, well, we don't want you here. But we've got our right to be there. They were arguing about public galleries. Should we be allowed, should we not?
I'm just curious.
Because the screws did not want the public gallery. I think they were that embarrassed what they were charged with.
Yeah.
Because they got off with it. They also got off with the Lord Brian.
Yeah, yeah. So what do you think is going to happen now? I don't mean like stuff that you can't say. I mean just what you can say.
People have got to know, right? Like these villages up there in Consad, like I used to go to a village up Consad, not even a mile away from the detention centre, and because I had family up there at the time.
Yeah.
And I used to go up there that odd Saturday night, and I went there one night and a certain officer was sitting with his wife. I went to the bar, Cummy was gone.
Aye.
Why? Why goes I've walked in?
Why do you think?
Because he's had something to hide.
Aye.
I think he's frightened because I expose him in front of his friends.
Could not be his friend, he's just smash his fucking face in.
My point is, I think everybody in them villages knew what was going on. For the kids that Neville Husband took out the detention centre.
Well, fuck me.
He took some out, mind.
Oh, and I heard I.
I
think it was Eric Sampson mentioned it.
He was. They were taking kids. Look what they're doing to Kevin Young. They took him out. They took him to a house. They put a pillowcase over his head. And you could see all these Dr. Martin boots. But he says to me, what puzzled me was the brown brogues.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, the governor wore a pair of brown brogues.
Yeah.
So why were they taking out the detention centre for? Them Dr. Martins could have been policemen.
Who knows?
In 1977, 78, a lot of policemen wore Dr. Martin boots.
Yeah.
My point is you don't know who's been involved. I think, I'm going to speculate this, I think it was one big paedophile ring.
Yeah.
And I think it goes so high.
Yeah.
Them are the scapegoats.
Definitely. I totally agree with that, right?
And what they've done to Eric Sampson was shocking.
Discussion.
That was shocking. A lad who was about 6.5 stone, about 4.5 foot high, it was shocking that people that were that high up could do that to somebody.
Yeah. I want to mention them. I set that Facebook group up over 10 years ago, and you know, it has been good. I mean, I know it must have been frustrating for people in there because everybody's got a different viewpoint on it. And like for me, it was quite hard to try and stay balanced and, you know, not let things get out of control. But the good thing that came about it was we met up in the corner house and we all had a drink together and it was fucking lush.
See, the thing is with the corner house, that was in like Heaton, Newcastle.
Yeah.
I don't know if you noticed, some kids had come from Middlesbrough.
Yeah.
Like, when you went to the court, when they were up at court on trial, it was all Middlesbrough kids.
Yeah.
And when you went to, like, the court at, where was it? Newton Aycliffe, it was all Durham kids.
Yeah,
yeah. If we could have got them all together.
Oh, that would have been amazing, right?
You know, it would have been great.
So not that can't be done. I just want to mention that because it was a really great feeling when I got to meet all these people who had been texting and all this lot and listening to their stories and these people are fucking so brave and strong.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? They're so brave and strong. But was us having a night and getting pissed up and that and meeting them? Did you like it?
I thoroughly enjoyed it. See, another, I'll say it now in case I forget. When Onslow, Broken Nose and McGee were sentenced, we all went to the bar across the road from the courts. It's called the Pig Iron. It's rough as fuck, but the people were lovely.
Aye, lush.
And we all had one table and we're the drinks back. And we're, I think there's a video of the Benzie one.
We're
all standing with drinks, celebrating Onslow getting his 8.5. Yeah, it was great.
That's fucking amazing.
I'd never thought, right, I'd see my day with him. Never thought in a million year.
I'll be happy when he's fucking dead, mate. Like, horrible cunt. Anyway, I'm going to fucking wind this down. So, I just want to thank you, Peter, for helping me.
Anytime, Brian. Anytime. Anytime.
It's been a long time coming.
It's an honour to be here.
Oh, it's been a long time coming. And I want to dedicate this to all the victims from Medomsley Detention Centre. And obviously my Facebook group, all the people on there. I love yous all. And stay safe, stay strong, and I'll catch you on the next one.